Shay took a look at the PowerPoint as he was downloading it and said 73 slides, 20 minutes, but let me assure you, it will go as like a thunderstorm. Huh? So thanks for being around. This sort of carries on forward from Sumita Narayan's presentation as of yesterday, when she was painting this big gory picture of India drowning in its own shit. And these people were called mafiosi. Mafia. This mafia, which is a criminal gang of people bent on exploiting society, is the beginning part of my presentation. And many of you, perhaps some of you would have seen these kind of yellow trucks moving around in urban areas, picking up sludge from septic tanks and pit toilets. And I'd like to call them honeysuckers, as it's called in some other parts of the world. My presentation is copyleft, it's on slide share, so you can download it at any point of time. I'm a firm believer in social media, so it's there on Twitter, YouTube, all this stuff is there. We can have conversations around it. And Zen Rainman is the hang that I go by. But I have to thank IRC and IWMI for help and support during parts of the documentation of this work. And Tushar for the title. It's not my choice, he put the title, so I'm just going on with it. So the investigation was essentially looking at how people in urban areas, small and medium towns and large cities, were not connected to the sewage, manage it. And what is the role of the informal sector, if there's any role at all? And is there any nutrient to use? Obvious questions. Broad investigations going on. So the census 2011 came at the right time, because for the first time, some numbers are emerging as to what the state of usage of toilets is, those who have toilets. And the numbers are staggering. 1.8.41 million pit toilets and septic tanks. And most of these septic tanks would be pit toilets, actually. We already have this kind of numbers, 1.8.41 million. And like it or lump it, we'll have to deal with the sludge from this. Another 113 million rural households, especially with the total sanitation campaign in the Nirmal Bharat Abhiyan, are busy building single pit toilets, more or less, all across the country. And insofar as I could read, there's no strategy for pit empty. There's no strategy for management of the sludge which would come from these pits and septic tanks. For my state alone, Karnataka, which I took a slightly more detailed look, only 29 towns in Bangalore have some form of partial coverage of underground sewage systems out of the 213 urban towns. Population is 9 million, 3 million people came in between 2001 to 2011. So it's a fast, rapidly expanding population base. And as we know, sewage systems don't expand as rapidly. It simply can't deal with incremental increase from, especially in the periphery. They're lumpy in nature and they take time to expand and reach out to people. So what do people do in the meantime? The city has been doing some very good things. Water utilities have some positive things to say about the city of Bangalore and what its utility does for water and sanitation. Some of them are listed out. So there are, for example, every connection, legal connection is metered. There's a volumetric tariff. There's an increasing block tariff. There's a pro-growth policy. Rainwater harvesting has been made mandatory and more than 100,000 buildings are harvesting rain. Urban water bodies are being refurbished and brought back into the mainstream of the city fabric. So there are positive things happening with the urban institutions, with water and sanitation. It's not enough with dissatisfied, but we have to work on what we have and then take it forward, rather than to sit back and critique it, as we seem to enjoy to do. The city, of course, has 500,000 pit toilets and septic tanks, not on the radar of the water utility, because the water utility looks at only underground sewage as the only form of sanitation. The issue that Aluwalia High Court Economic Committee, which gave its report on what urban infrastructure would require as funds, also saw only sewage as the solution or the way forward, and put up an astronomically high figure. Well, as and when the money comes, what do people do? That would be something that we need to do. And the key thing to realize that the current driver of sanitation in at least urban Karnataka has nothing to do with sanitation at all. It comes from the Knowledge Carrying Act. And the High Courts and the Human Rights Commission are really cracking down very hard on manual scavenging. And this manual cracking down on manual scavenging, which was about time to be done, is now unleashing certain forms of thinking and engagement as to what we should do with sanitation. So is manual cleaning, how is manual cleaning to be done? The Manual Scavenging Act says you cannot get down manuals. No individual can get down manuals. This is the Manual Scavenging Act, which is a bill which is in Parliament, which is still being debated, which is yet to be passed. But already signs are there that the form of engagement with sanitation and sewage will be radically different in the coming years. The city sanitation system has, of course, 7,500 kilometers of sewage lines in place, 24 sewage treatment plants, and 650,000 connections. Now, you have 5,000 pit toilets and septic tanks, 650,000 sewage connections, almost equal. And the 500,000 septic tanks and pit toilets are growing. And there's a great deal of difficulty in picking up sewage, getting the sewage treatment plants to run, treating it effectively and releasing it into the environment, of which the biggest constraint is that the political economy of tariffs. You cannot charge the true price for sewage, collection, conveyance, and treatment. It's simply been impossible. So it's not a technical issue as much as a political, economic, financial issue, and a vote issue. So people are charged 15 rupees a month, 50 paisa a day as sanitation charges if you are connected to the utility lines. Whereas the actual cost is 18 rupees per kiloliter. This includes capex and omex for collecting, conveying, and treating sewage to the pollution control board norms, 18 rupees per kiloliter. The externality, of course, is for us to see every day, four rivers. This is the British poverty which used to flow out of Bangalore. For 4 kilometers, you couldn't see four, which is 8 or 10 feet in height. Now, as long as it's underground sewerage, the utility, the Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board is in charge, so you can complain to them. But as long as, when it comes to on-plot sanitation, you have a multiplicity of institutions. The city corporation, which approves the building plan in the form of sewage disposal. The water supply and sewerage board, which theoretically is responsible for sewerage, can it manage septic? The state pollution control board, which is responsible for both sewage, treated sewage, as well as septic being put on land. The agriculture department, if this is going as a nutrient, then somewhere the agriculture department has a role to look at it as a nutrient. And funnily enough, the transport department, which seems to be the only department which has a handle on the private water tankers moving about in the city and these honeysuckers moving about in the city to empty pit toilets and septic tanks. No other institution has any clue at all. It's just the transport department and its 8 RTO offices which have some numbers. So how are informal sectors playing a role in sanitation, urban sanitation? Well, for example, they make banks and WCs. Nobody even factors them as part of a solution to space. They make concrete rigs. They make the vacuum trucks, and there are farmers who are taking the nutrients. How do these people fit in into a city sanitation plan? I've seen 300 city sanitation plans, which the JNNURM has and the National Urban Sanitation Policy has brought forward. But I don't see much room for these people, as mentioned in those city sanitation plans. How can we incorporate them would be something. The nice thing about these conventional informal systems is that people are used to it. Unlike, let's say, EcoSan or urine diversion dry toilets, when we talk about these high funded technologies, you're talking about behavior change somewhere. But here, the user interface with the toilet is the same. You sit on it or spot on it, and then it goes in. And here are the ring manufacturers on empty site making these concrete rings pre-cast. And that's how it ends up as a pit toilet in the Bangalore context. These guys will turnkey deliver a pit toilet to you. They'll come to put the rings into it. And the business of sanitation is picking up. All these cars are now floating around where you call these people on a mobile phone, like so, and they come and they'll empty the pit toilet for you. This is a honeysuckle in operation in the Bangalore context. Is this elimination of manual scavenging? There should be a question mark here because there should be no direct contact between fecal sludge and people's hands, so protective gloves, stuff like that should need to come into picture. We have a robust manufacturing base, a second-hand Tata chassis, steel plates bought from Hyderabad, pumps bought from Coimbatore, thrown together in a bodybuilding workplace, and we have the vacuum truck ready in 15 days. Fantastic indigenous technology. Both water jetting and vacuum sucking. So if the sludge is too thick, they pump in the water at high pressure, slurry it up, and then vacuum suck it. And assembly the honeysucker is now an informal sector business across many cities and towns. Balance coming in. So we really have to thank our manufacturing base for solutions in sanitation which come up. And it's a mobile technology. People talk about mobile phones and toilets all the time, making comparisons, strange comparisons. But here, the sanitation delivery guy uses the mobile phone for him to be reached. He doesn't need an office. He sits around in a restaurant or in his home. And all he has is a mobile phone, and he works his business with that. We estimate that there are close to 300 honeysuckers in Bangalore. Not our official figures at all. We need to evolve a safe disposal, obviously. And the sewage is nutrient rich, it's getting on farms like this. People would be horrified, but the farmers know what they're doing broadly. They grow Bermuda grass and Mexico grass, Mexican grass on this, and sell it to the richest in the city at 25 rupees a square feet. They take the shit of the rich and sell it back to them at 25 rupees a square foot. I mean, it's brilliant business. No other business makes money like shit business. The cost of the building for emptying a pit toilet varies from 800 to 3,000 rupees. Yeah, which is, I'm showing you, is pretty good. And in terms of ecological thinking, this is actually going to land where it's a nutrient, unlike water, where it would be a polluted. So it's absolutely brilliant. Fair. Many apartments are daily visit. Because apartments have been mandated with sewage treatment plants, which don't work, the owners association doesn't know what the hell to do with it. The pollution control board is mandatory. So what they end up doing is getting these guys to come in daily to empty their sewage treatment plants, septic tanks. The most expensive of buildings, the richest apartments, the apartments sell for 2.5 crores, but there's a honeysuckle going in and out almost daily. People used to squat behind bushes, now the honeysuckle squat behind bushes, so behind the bushes is the thing. And many people would ask, is this large-scale open defecation? If you're dumping a honeysuckle load on land, is this large-scale open defecation? The city utility has bought 60 sucking and jetting machines. It's done that. It doesn't know what to do with it, so it's trying to figure that out. And it has come up with some kind of a protocol where it says that it will charge 50 rupees a kilometer for the sewage to be brought to its sewage treatment plant. But after 500,000 connections that need to take this permission and work legally, only about 75 permits have been issued. The city is not very keen to push that 75 to 500,000. For other towns, there are now, every town is getting a honeysuckle because of the High Court dicta. So we're going to get 213 honeysuckles in each one of the towns without a protocol for pit emptying, without knowing where it is to be done, and what happens to towns and cities where there's no sewage treatment plant. But luckily, perhaps we can refer to some old documents and take things forward. The FAO, long back, has come on with on-farm composting methods, and as early as 1939, Acharya details out the Bangalore method of composting, the Indore method of composting and the Bangalore composting method, which actually uses fecal sludge, describes it very well as to what should be done. I won't get into the details of it, it's up there, but it's a very simple process of digging a pit and putting the sludge, it's an anaerobic decomposition, layering it with farmyard manure and leaves, and allowing it to compost for 3 to 6 months. So, accepted practice. Perhaps we need to bring it back for sludge treatment. And perhaps the agriculture guys have to come up with it. So the whole process is described pretty much in detail. Strange that an idea originates from a city but is completely forgotten in the city itself. So we need sometime to go back. And this is how it works. Farmers are doing it now, indirectly. They dig these trenches, get the sludge in, cover it up with farmyard manure, cover it up with soil, allow it to compost and then sell it. They also differentiate between grey water and black water. They take the grey water differently. So the shit coming from apartments, rich apartments, is valued much less than the shit which comes from individual homes, which has rotted and composted well. So there's a gradation and classification of shit, which the farmer does, you know, brilliantly. And they use it for all sorts of trees and plants. Coconut and areca nut are a favorite. The compost sells for 2,500 to 3,500 rupees a tractor load, equal to or higher than farmyard manure. So obviously we need to start putting in place a protocol of testing this, figuring out what the nutrient content is, what the pathogens is. Again, it's a World Health Organization monograph on how to take city sludge, human sludge, and make these rows and patterns and then compost it well without soil and air pollution, water pollution, and be able to do it well. So fertilizer value needs to be analyzed, put in place, systems need to be put in place. We need to think about land use planning because the city is moving in. And so these places of sludge composting are being threatened and people have to go more and more. And the biggest threat actually comes from toll roads. Because if a honeysuckle now has to go on a toll road, it has to pay 200 bucks and so it increases cost. And as the city roads are getting toll, they're trying to find narrower and narrower gullies to get out of the city for free so that they reach the land at cheaper prices. So strange, the tolling starts to affect sanitation. And there is application on bananas. I don't have to tell you. We've been documenting some of this and absolutely fantastic and healthy fruits. The soil alive with ants and bones, so doesn't fit in as organic agriculture because human waste cannot be used in organic agriculture. So there are certain economics here. Now, this is slightly old because the market is now saturated, so the rate of the return on investment is no longer 6 months. It used to be 6 months. If you put in 800,000 for a truck, you got back the money, the 8 lakhs in 6 months. It's now about 2 years. economics for a household is that at 60 rupees a month, you have a financially viable, completely state-independent septage management model. The economics for a farmer works out fantastically well. He saves between 20,000 to 50,000 rupees a day. Because for him, the sludge is virtually free, the compost. The land required for nutrient absorption for a city, the numbers are starting to emerge. We don't really need huge amounts of land if we are going to compost sludge for entire cities and use it as a farmyard manure, as opposed to sewage treatment plants, very expensive, and putting that down into rivers. So the way forward is a better understanding of the business practice, of the informal sector practice, and try to include public health, hygiene standards, nutrient standards, and improve them gradually in phased fashion. Also to understand the impact on water, say watersheds, and try to identify sludge drying and composting land so that watersheds are not affected, and in Himanshu's favorite way, that aquifers are also not affected. We have the wherewithal, but we need to put it all together as a package and go take it out. So legal framework, institutional framework. But seriously, I do believe that the quote-unquote predatory state has the capacity, the wherewithal, or the ability to deliver this. As long as this is below the radar, it works brilliantly and well. The moment the state steps in, we're going to screw it up. So we need interventions at designs of septic tanks, better designs of pit toilets, building plan approvals which take into consideration good designs. We have to include on-plot sanitation as one safe method of sanitation, which we don't seem to think that it is there. Perhaps we need to separate grey water and black water. We have to work with the organization guidelines on sanitation safety plans. Thick, dense documents. If you think that this is a thick, dense slide, you have to look at the four volume documents of the World Health Organization on sanitation safety plan. It will take a double PhD to understand it. We have to simplify that so that city institutions are better able to understand and use it as a checklist. So, conclusion is this, that there's a significant informal sector playing its role in urban sanitation. Its role has not been recognized, it's below the radar. There is significant nutrient use happening. And the elimination of manual scavenging can only happen through a process of mechanization. And that mechanization includes these kind of vacuum trucks, which is run by the informal sector as a business. Thank you.